Everybody, my name is Whitney O'Reilly. I'm going to wait as people trickle in. I'm really just going to reintroduce myself. Hopefully many of you have attended some of my webinars before. I try to do a 30 minute, 45 minute or an hour, something like a lunch and learn just about each month. Sometimes I miss a month if I am in a trial, if I'm in court, sometimes that doesn't happen. But most of the time, I try to do this once a month for clients, potential clients, family, friends, just to give you a little bit of information about this area of the law. A client who is better prepared will get a better result. So that's part of what you're doing, is joining me to learn a little bit more about this area of the law. So again, my name is Whitney O'Reilly. I chair our wealth preservation department here at Cohen Seglius. We manage estate planning, estate administration, trust administration, basically in Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Delaware, New York, Maryland, Virginia, and DC. So any of those areas, we have these services, whether it's estate planning, which is drafting your will or your trust, the document that says what happens with your things when you're not here anymore, those power of attorney documents, so somebody can help make decisions for you if you become incapacitated, including things like a living will, to an estate administration, doing a full probate through that state's court system and filing state level and federal level death taxes, creating trust in each of those jurisdictions, administering those trusts, and then sometimes terminating those trusts. So as I see more and more trickling in, again, I'm just introducing myself. My name is Whitney O'Reilly. I run our wealth preservation department. I try to do these webinars each and every month. Today, what we're going to learn about is a little bit of legislative updates. We're going to have a state level case update and a client update, all from this past year, 2022. So that we can learn a little bit moving forward in 2023, what worked, what didn't work, what are these changes, and what, if anything, should I as a consumer be doing moving forward? So in about 1 minute, I'm going to get started. I always forget to say this. If you have a question, you can type it into the Q&A or the, I don't remember if it's the Q&A or the chat box. Do it into either. We keep track of it. So I'll get I'll get a little list of anyone who's asked questions. If you ask questions and it seems pertinent to the group, I will certainly pose it and give the answer. If it's something specific or off topic, I'll certainly try to email you afterwards. Do remember, if you type my name into the World Wide Web, you can pull up my information. Feel free to shoot me an email. Feel free to give my office a call and schedule an appointment if you have any questions. I'm always happy to answer them. Again, I chair the wealth preservation section of our firm. And without further ado, I'm going to get started. So again, if you have any questions, type them right into the Q&A. I'll try to keep track of them. And again, answer if I can. Now, this is a quick, just 30 minutes. So hopefully won't interrupt your lunchtime too much, or maybe you can be chomping down on something at the same time. I have been practicing in this arena for about 20 years now. So I have a lot of knowledge specific to this area of the law. So we're going to start by talking about a legislative update. What happened in 2022 that affects us here in 2023? So the first thing we're going to talk about is the IRS update, right? The Internal Revenue Code that allows us to have an annual gift tax exemption. So I'll sort of pause here and explain this by saying, if we give money to anyone during our lifetime or at death, it's subject to tax. But under the Internal Revenue Code, we exempt a small amount each year per individual. And last year, the annual personal exemption was $16,000 per individual. This year, for 2023, that has been updated to $17,000 per individual. So this is the first bit of planning I'm giving you, which is, you can give $17,000 without paying any tax and without it coming off of your lifetime exemption that we're going to talk about next, so that no tax is incurred when we're transferring an asset to a successive, let's say, generation. So I can give, I have two children. I can give my daughter $17,000. I can give my son $17,000. I can give my nephew $17,000. I can give my niece $17,000. That is one way to sort of move assets from one place to another in a very strategic way so that we can avoid death taxes. Now, of course, we want to consult our advisory team before we make any large gifts, because there could be issues with those gifts. One of the gifts I just talked about was to someone who's 10 years old. I have a 10-year-old son. Should he get $17,000 this year? Maybe not. Maybe if I'm giving him $100,000, I should put it inside of a trust. Maybe I should put it into a uniform transfers to minors account. So there's lots of things that we can or can't do. And then along with this legislative update of changing the exemption amount to a little higher amount, we have the same thing happening with the lifetime exemption. So over your lifetime or at death, you can give in 2022 $12.09 million without paying any federal death tax. So we're going to stop here for a second. What is the death tax? So right now I'm sitting here in Pennsylvania. So we're going to talk about Pennsylvania. So Pennsylvania has a death tax. It's called the inheritance tax. That is the state level death tax. And that depends on who the asset goes to, what the tax is. So if it's to a spouse, 0%. If it is to your child, it's a 4.5% tax. If it is to your sibling, it's a 12% tax. And if it's to your friend, it's a 15% tax. It includes all of your assets, basically, except life insurance. Anything you have, whether it's held in a revocable trust, held in your individual name, whether it has beneficiaries or not, all subject to that death tax. And we also have the federal tax to contend with. That's a 40% tax. That's not a nice one. We normally want to plan to pay as little, if none of that tax as possible. And so this is the exemption, this $12.09 million. It's been moved to 12.92 million for 2023. So it just means you can give a little more, 12.92 million to anyone in the entire world without paying that 40% death tax. So we've got that in place. The only problem with this plan is that the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act that created this big exemption is going to sunset this large exemption back down to 5 million at the end of 2025. So what does that mean for us moving forward in 2023? We've got a lot of exemption that we can use that's going to go away at the end of 2025. So what should we be doing? One, we should be updating our estate plan. The very basic level, we should make sure that we have something called a spousal trust underneath our plan, whether it's a disclaimer trust or a credit shelter trust, or an AB trust, or a Q-tip trust, or a simple marital trust with a general power of appointment. All of those things are going to, in some way, if drafted correctly, make sure that we get to use both spouses' exemption so that if something does happen to you, we can at least shelter that first spouse's exemption, that 12.92 million, or whatever that number is at that particular time. If we're very wealthy, and this is normally a question people ask me, well, when is it that I should do more advanced planning than that? And the answer is right now, I'd say if we're butting up against $10 million, that's what the exemption is basically going to go back down to. That's when you need to look at one, updating your estate plan, and maybe two, doing some advanced planning in the next 2 years to account for this very large exemption going away so that we can protect our assets from the 40% tax that is looming. And I'm also saying 40% tax, but it's gone up as high as 55% in the past. So some things that we can do, one, There's a spousal limited access trust. It's called a SLAT. That's one way we can use up some of that exemption during lifetime. We have maybe one spouse do it or two. It takes that asset out for estate tax purposes, uses up some of that exemption, and the growth in that asset is then out forever from that federal estate tax. Works actually similarly to the next one, which is called a GRAT, a grantor retained annuity trust. So these are all phase two trust planning vehicles to maximize the tax savings creditor protection that we can pass on to our family members. So a grantor retained annuity trust does, it's an estate freeze technique. So it uses some of our exemption, or maybe not if it's zeroed out. We can have a whole webinar about some of these very sophisticated plans, but just an idea to jot down, and you can look it up on the internet, or you can talk to your estate planning attorney and say, you know, I listened to this webinar. I understand that we've had this legislative change where the exemptions have gotten a little bit bigger for 2023. I know we only have kind of 24 months or so to maybe do some advanced planning. This is my wealth level. And these are some of the things that this attorney talked about, a SLAT, a GRAT. We're going to talk about an ILIT, which is an irrevocable life insurance trust. Should I create a trust and fund it with life insurance that then won't be subject to that federal estate tax? Whereas if you have life insurance now, it's payable to your spouse or down to your children, it will be included in the total that is subject to that 40% tax when you pass away. And then also along those lines, there's just basic irrevocable trust planning, which is taking some of your assets and giving them away for someone else. So if, let's say, I have $20 million, maybe I want to take $5 million and fund it into a trust for my grandchildren, maybe separate trust for grandchildren or a pot trust for grandchildren. Maybe we want to GST that trust. So that's another tax we have to think about when we're becoming into that ultra wealthy category, the generation skipping transfer tax. That's an additional 40% tax, very onerous tax that we want to make sure we maximize when we're distributing assets out to beneficiaries, whether or not it's GST'd. So again, this first part that we're talking about is the legislative update that increased the annual amount we can give to individuals. That's $17,000 per individual. That lifetime and death exemption, that is $12.92 million. And we understand that this law is going to sunset at the end of 2025. Remember this as well. There are other provisions of that law that sunset. If you're in the highest tax bracket, you saw something that felt a little bit nice, which you went from 39.6% to 30% tax rate. That's going to go back to 39.6. The same with giving assets out to charities and getting deductions. The deduction amount is going to be a little bit lower. It's going to limit that amount. Just remember, if for some reason one of you does not have a citizenship of the United States, that amount that is allowed to go to the surviving spouse, which I believe is $175,000 right now, that's going to go back down as well. So if you have one non-citizen spouse, it's incredibly important to do that planning. Because here in the United States, if there are two US citizens, that death tax that I'm talking about doesn't come into play until the death of the second spouse. Now, this case update that we're going to talk about next actually shows that that sometimes is not the case. But for all intents and purposes, when I pass away, if I give all $20 million that I hold to my spouse, he won't owe death tax until he passes away. But again, there are some things that we should be doing inside of here to maximize that tax savings. And again, along with this legislative change, I just want to say the Pennsylvania Inheritance Tax Act was updated. And this was, I want to say, the end of 2020. So not quite a 2022 legislative change, but there's a lot of lawyers and individuals that, because it's so new, forget that this provision is in place, which is, if a parent passes away, so if I were to pass away, as you know, I have a 10-year-old son. If I were to pass away, my husband and I pass away together, and all of our assets go down to our children. If they're under the age of 21, there is no death tax. It's a 0% tax rate for state level taxes. 2 years ago, that was not the case. They were subject to a Pennsylvania inheritance tax. So just keep that in mind. I'm knocking on wood because I'd like to stick around for a little while. But that's a new piece of legislation. So when we have a tragic death where we have minor children, important to know that the tax has actually changed a little bit. So the next thing that we're going to talk about, and I'll sort of pause for a second and say, does anybody have any questions about state level death tax, federal level death tax, the annual exemption, the unlimited marital deduction, the deduction, the lifetime exemption that you have over your lifetime, or any of these planning techniques that I was talking about, the SLAT, the GRAT, the irrevocable life insurance trust, and then that family maybe pot irrevocable trust. Certainly you can put it in the Q&A, but we'll move on to the second of three things that we're going to talk about today, which is a case update. So this case came out in 2022. So what does that mean for us for 2023? Well, I just explained that we have an unlimited marital deduction between spouses for federal purposes, and between spouses at the state level, at least here in Pennsylvania, it's a 0% tax. I'll pause for a second and say, we do represent clients in many states here in the Northeast, most of which do have a death tax. Some don't have a death tax and either have probate fees that look like death taxes. So if you think, well, I don't live in Pennsylvania, I live in New Jersey, so does this really impact me? And the answer is yes. New Jersey had two death taxes. One was because was called the estate tax. It was repealed in 2018. And the other is called the inheritance tax. And that also depends on who the beneficiary is, what the tax is. Lots of states do still have some version of a state level death tax or probate fees that work in a similar way. So it's important to understand that. But even if you're in a state that, let's say, has low probate fees, doesn't have a death tax, we still have to contend with that federal estate tax and make sure that we're either not paying the tax if we don't have to, or maximizing the amount that goes out to family and we pay the least amount of tax possible. So now we get to this case update. It was the estate of Armour Family Trust. And so first, I'm going to explain the story of what happened. So here we had a husband and wife. It was William and Josephine. They went to an estate planning attorney and they had something created for them called a joint revocable trust. I am not always a fan of a joint revocable trust. It is legal to draft them in all states anyway that we practice in here in the Northeast. But the reason that I don't always like them is this very case. They get very confusing. If they're not drafted correctly, they can have dire tax consequences, which is what we're going to see. So husband and wife, they created this joint revocable trust. They funded it with about $4 million. William passed away a couple of years ago. They probated the estate, to get the portability provision. We didn't talk about that, but there's something under the law called portability where you can take someone's unused exemption and port it on top of yourself so that you get more exemption. That was part of that estate planning that we were talking about, getting that spousal trust in place so that we can make sure that we automatically are able to do that. But in this case, that's probably why they administered the estate. In doing that, they filed a Pennsylvania inheritance tax return where they said there was a 0% tax due. They filed a federal estate tax return showing an unlimited marital deduction. And for federal purposes, we're not going to worry about what happened thereafter. But now we're worried about state level what's happened. So they filed all this and Pennsylvania Department of Revenue came back and their appraisement said, I'm sorry, but under the Inheritance Tax Act, this trust is subject to a 15% tax. and you owe us interest and penalties for a total amount of, instead of zero, $500,000 in tax. It's probably not a piece of paper I would like to see. So the family was in turmoil. Oh my gosh, $500,000 in tax. We only have $4 million in this trust. The surviving spouse is still living. If it went outright to her, there would be absolutely no tax. But here we've got this trust. And so their reasoning was, under the Inheritance Tax Act in Code Section 2107 and C7 and C5, there's something called, if we don't have a sole use trust for the surviving spouse, it does not qualify as going specifically to the surviving spouse. And we have to count everyone that this asset could possibly go to, as in the 15% tax rate, because the trust says principal can be distributed to the spouse, but also out to anyone else, subjecting it all to this tax. So of course the family appealed their decision. Orphans Court said, all right, the law says that, but we've got some other general provisions that sort of say a spouse is supposed to be taxed at a 0% tax rate. We're not quite sure if this is a grantor trust or became irrevocable. And again, here is where I stop and say, this is where joint revocable trusts often cause an issue. If something is fully revocable, it kind of counts as yours. So again, there would be that 0% tax consequence. But here we've got something in between. When the first spouse passed away, did something become irrevocable? And then that irrevocable trust, is it for the sole use of the spouse, or is it allowed for other people? And so the Orphans Court didn't really have a good response, but said, we want to agree with this taxpayer that it's zero. So we're going to say it's zero. Department of Revenue appealed that decision and said, we like that you want to help the taxpayers out, but this is what the tax code says. This is what it is for state level purposes. And so this decision came out, I want to say, in November. And the decision actually is a wonderful decision for taxpayers, which is the Orphans Court ruling was upheld. Basically, the reasoning is there's some other provisions in the tax code that are more specific, and that sole use trust is a little bit more general. So they're saying the specific language of a different code section trumps that general provision. Not entirely sure. I trust that this won't be appealed again. I think it's a very loose law that they're hanging on. But really what this tells us is, if we have a joint revocable trust, if we have a revocable trust, if we have any kind of trust in our estate plan, we want to get it looked at and make sure it's the right kind of trust. Because a long time ago, you used to not have to have a sole use trust. The law changed and made it taxable. So there are very old trusts that I see, or joint revocable trusts that don't work quite right, that are affected by this. And we want to make sure when we're transferring assets to our spouse or down to our children, we're not incurring a tax. Here, there's a tax of $500,000. Would each of you like an additional $500,000? $500,000? And the answer is yes, we all would. Whether our family members only have 500,000, or we have 4 million, or we have 15 million, we want to make sure that money goes out to our family members. So we want to look at those trusts that we have in place. And this also kind of goes along with the third thing I'm going to talk about in the last 5 minutes that I have you, which is a client update, which is we really need to understand the assets that you have to make sure you have a coordinated estate plan and that you have a simpler, inexpensive estate administration. How do you hold your assets? Do you hold them jointly? Do you hold them jointly by tenants by the entirety? Do you own them by tenants in common? Do you just own them individually? Do you have a beneficiary designation? All of those things matter. So now we're going to get to, we talked about the legislative update from 2022 to 2023. We've talked about this case update, this Armour Family Trust, which actually had a good result for our client here in Pennsylvania. I'm just not so sure it's the winning argument. And really what that tells us, me as a practitioner and you as a consumer, is make sure you've got the right kind of trust in place. Sometimes you get what you pay for. If you're going to a general practitioner and they're trying to do very sophisticated things, they might not do it correctly and they might not know that they're not doing it correctly. But you are going to be better armed because you're listening to this webinar. You're going to come on next month and the next month, and you're going to know this information, and you're going to circle back with your financial team, your financial advisor, your financial planner, your accounting team, your legal team, and you're going to make sure that you've got the right plan in place for you. Once in a while, this needs to be checked. Sometimes clients ask me, how often should I check this plan? Some people check it once a year. Some people wait till something happens. There's a birth or a death in the family. A business is about to be sold, to sort of check in. I'd say at the very least, every 5 to 7 years. Here, because we have a major tax change happening at the end of 2025, 2024. Reach out to your team and say, what, if anything, will affect me and my family so that I can transfer as much wealth to my loved ones in the most creditor protected and tax advantaged way. So again, this client update, remember, I have something called the attorney-client privilege. So what that means is, generally, I can't share specific information about a case, about people's names, with anyone in the world. So if you're hearing me talk about a specific case, it's either been changed enough that it's a more general story, or I've talked to those clients about presenting that specific fact pattern and whether or not they're okay with, for educational purposes, sharing that with others. So this is that particular case. So here, legislative update, we've got a case update, and now we've got this client update. This is a beneficiary designation blunder. I have done, in the 20 years I've been practicing, maybe 2,000 estate and trust administrations. One out of every 10 has a beneficiary designation problem. So don't think this is one in a million and something like this never happens. It happens all the time. After you get off this call, this weekend, next week, look at how you hold your assets. Look at what the beneficiary designations are. You don't even have to pay an attorney to do that. You don't have to pay a financial advisor to do that. It's just something you can go back and look at to make sure it says what we want it to say. So here I had an estate administration. I had a very large life insurance policy. And the life insurance policy was payable to the gentleman who passed away, second wife. He had been divorced from her for a number of years, had actually been remarried, and that new spouse had passed away. The estate administration had a will that said everything went down to his two children. And we assumed that the life insurance policy was either updated to his current spouse or updated to his children. We reached out to the life insurance company. They let us know that it was a previous spouse. The family went, are you kidding me? This money is going to go out to somebody he divorced 10 years ago, millions of dollars. And the answer is yes or no. And so what I mean by that is, in Pennsylvania and many other states we practice in, we have updated laws to say if a divorce has been finalized, and finalized is a little bit tricky. Sometimes you can still be in the middle of a divorce and it counts as a divorce, so it can be very fact specific. If we have a divorce situation under the Pennsylvania Estate and Fiduciaries Code, that's really the law that regulates this area of the law in Pennsylvania anyway. And we've also talked about the Pennsylvania Inheritance and Estate Tax Act that regulates taxes here in Pennsylvania. We talked about the Internal Revenue Code, which is the tax code for federal purposes here in the United States. But under the PEF code in section 6111, it says that if you divorce this person and you forgot to update your beneficiary designations, it will basically update it for you. It will cross out that person, and the assets will flow whether to your estate or, if the company has a different default setting, to your family members. Wonderful. That sounds perfect. That's exactly what we wanted to have happen with this life insurance policy. Problem. This life insurance policy, because of where it came from, because of his employment, was actually guided by ERISA, which is the federal law governing employer-sponsored plans. And under ERISA, they have not updated this provision under the law. So because this is an ERISA plan, the original beneficiary designation stands. So what does that tell you? One, that tells you, make sure you've updated your beneficiary designations. Here in Pennsylvania and many other states, we try to have default laws that sort of do what we think people would want to have done. But one, that doesn't always mirror what people's intentions are. And two, it can be mucked up. Federal law preempts state law. Here in this case in Pennsylvania, that law didn't come into play until 2010. So if this was a policy before that, if they got divorced before that, that would also, it's not a retroactive piece of legislation. Sometimes we do have retroactive legislation pieces. That's not this. So we want to go back and update those designations. Now, I know we're about a minute over, so I'm going to wrap this up and just say, you know, from 2022 to 2023, had some legislative changes. We've had some case law updates, had some interesting client cases we've worked on. And really the main takeaways is talk to your financial team. Very soon, there's a big exemption going away, subjecting more of your assets to a possible 40% tax. Check on it. If you have an old plan in place, it may not work the way you want it to. Check it. Check your beneficiary designations and how you hold titles to your assets so that they go to, one, the right people, and we subject them to the least amount of tax, and we do it in the most creditor-protected way. So again, this is my update from 2022 to 2023. Thank you all for joining this Lunch and Learn. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me, email me, call my office. Always, you could type things in the Q&A. And I just appreciate you joining me. I appreciate you trying to learn a little bit more about this area of the law. Again, more knowledge means more protection, a better plan, less tax, more creditor protected advantages for you and for your family members. So it's awesome that you're part of this. It's awesome that you're thinking about this. And I hope you all had a wonderful holiday season. And we all have a very happy new year here in 2023. And I hope to see many of you, well, not see you, you'll see me. I hope many of you sign up for some of my other webinars. If there's ever a topic that you want to hear about, certainly let me know. I try to make sure it's something that I've either experienced in that year regarding lots of cases about a particular area of the law, an issue that we're seeing over and over again, trying to arm you with as much information as possible, because it's really important. The things that we have amassed over our lifetime, we want to make sure go to our loved ones and in the most protected way, and that we pay the least amount of tax, and our family members, our children, our spouses, our family members get as much money as humanly possible so that they can move forward and do the same thing for their family members. So again, thank you so much to all of you for listening to me. Again, this was a legislative update and how to move forward with your estate plan. Do know that that exemption is going away. So check in with your team. And I look forward to seeing you next month. Thanks, everybody. Happy 2023.